chemistry solution. This tutorial is on rate laws, rate constants, and reaction order, and there's a lot to cover in this topic, so this is kind of just an introduction, and there will be tutorials that follow that delve more into how you actually determine rate laws. A lot of times when you calculate a reaction rate, you're calculating the reaction rate as an average over a certain period of time. And that's a little bit inaccurate because reaction rates often change over time, and that's because the concentration of reactants changes over time. So in general, reaction rates are going to decrease as the concentration of reactants decrease and increase as the concentration of reactants increase. What you can come up with is actually a rate law, which is an equation that expresses the rate of reaction at any given concentration of reactants. The rate law includes what's called a rate constant, and that's a lowercase k, that's specific to each reaction, and constant for each reaction. The rate law, including K, must be experimentally determined. It can't be determined by looking at a chemical equation. So let me just show you what I mean. So just to note from looking at those examples, and this is what I've been talking about, the exponents of the reactants in the rate law may be the same as the coefficients in the balanced equation, but not necessarily. Some reactants don't show up in the rate law at all, and so this is why the rate law and the rate constant must be determined experimentally. Another thing to note is you see this rate constant K in each of these rate laws, and I didn't put the value for K in the examples, but K is something that's specific to each reaction. So K would have a different value for each of the examples that I've shown you here. And in the next tutorial in this series, we'll actually look at how you can determine what the rate law is and how you can calculate K using experimental data. Okay, let's talk about reaction order. The reaction order is really just the exponent of the individual reactants in the rate law. So if you look at the first example, that reaction would be a second order reaction with respect to NO2. And if you look at the last example, that reaction would be second order with respect to ammonia and also second order with respect to oxygen. You can also talk about the overall reaction order, and that would be the sum of the exponents of the reactants in the rate law. Remember, again, if there's not an exponent written, that's the same as writing an exponent of 1. So let's look at some examples. Let's determine the overall reaction order for each of these examples that I've given you. And really determining the overall reaction order is as simple as adding up the exponents for each of the reactants in the rate law. So our first example is a second order reaction. Our second example would be a first order reaction. Our third example would be a second order reaction because it's first order with respect to C2H4Br. And it's also first order with respect to potassium iodide, so second order overall. And our fourth example is a fourth order reaction. So second order with respect to NH3, second order with respect to O2, fourth order overall. The very last thing that I'm going to cover in this tutorial is how to determine what the unit of your rate constant is going to be. You need to know that the unit of the rate constant is going to vary depending on the rate law, and it's going to depend on the overall reaction order of that rate law. And it has to be whatever necessary for the units of rate to make sense. So let me show you what I mean. For example, if you have a first order reaction, so just in general, that would be the rate is equal to your rate constant times the concentration of one of your reactants raised to the first power. Your rate is always going to be given in units of concentration per time, and those might change a little bit, so it depends on the experimental data that you have. And it doesn't matter whether you have molar or millimolar or seconds or minutes or hours. You just need to adjust the units for the rate constant so that the units of rate work out. And again, this is just dependent on the data that you have. So let's say, for example, we have a rate that is given to us in units of molar per second. You could also write this as molar times inverse seconds. That's the same thing. Molar per second or molar times inverse seconds, that's the same thing. The units for the concentration of your reactant are generally going to be the same as the units of concentration that's given in your rate. So in this case, if we calculated our rate in molar per second, we were probably calculating the concentration of our reactant in molar. What that means is that if the rate has units of molar times inverse seconds, and our reactant has units in concentration of molar, our rate constant must have units, in this case, of inverse seconds. So this is an example for a first order reaction. And you're going to follow this same process regardless of the units that you're given for rate and the units that you're given for the concentration of your reactants. And we will also be doing more of this in the next tutorial where we're determining rate laws for ourselves. Let's just look at one more example. So in this case, let's say we have a second order reaction. That could be the rate is equal to the rate constant times the concentration of A to the second power. Or a second order reaction could be the rate is equal to the rate constant times the concentration of one reactant times the concentration of another reactant. And it doesn't matter how you write that. A second order reaction is a second order reaction. So your rate is still going to be the same. You're going to look at the rate of product production or reactant disappearance, but that's always going to be concentration divided by time. So for example, molar per second or molar times inverse seconds. And if you look at the other side of our equation, whether you have concentration of A squared or the concentration of A times the concentration of B, the concentration of A would be molar, and it's raised to the second power in this equation, so molar squared or molar times molar. If you look at my other example of a second order reaction, you would have the concentration of A in molar times the concentration of B in molar. Again, that's the same thing as molar squared. So it doesn't make a difference there. What specifically your rate law looks like, as long as it's a second order reaction, those units are going to be the same. Now, what this means is that your units for your rate constant are going to be different depending on the overall reaction order. So the units for a rate constant for a first order reaction are going to be different than the units of a rate constant for a second order reaction. So in this example, again, our rate is molar times inverse seconds, but then the concentration we have on the other side is molar squared, which means in this case, the units of our rate constant are going to be inverse molar times inverse seconds. And so what I mean by they need to make the units for the rate make sense, if you take your units for your rate constant, inverse molar times inverse seconds, and you take them times your units of concentration, in this case molar times molar, when you multiply those units together, you should be left with molar times inverse seconds, or the units of your rate. Okay, hopefully that was helpful. That's kind of a brief introduction of rates and rate constants. We will be looking at this more when we delve into how to determine rate laws in the next tutorial. So thanks for watching.